What is the role of prayers, yantra, tantra, and mantra in Hindu worship?
Some of the practices we use to become more spiritually enlightened are, first is prayers. Prayer basically is find a way of communicating with a higher principle or a personality. Prayer is a way of appeasing and getting closer to him. It's a cry of the soul to link up with the Supreme. If you spend some time doing prayers, it gives you a tremendous sense of satisfaction that you attempted to link up with the higher ideal. Then you've got these three other words that have been used quite often. The words are tantra, mantra, and yantra. The idea of yantra is if you want to become spiritual, become very one-pointed and focused. When you focus on the yantra, colorful diagram, your eyes are immediately drawn to the center in an unusual manner with all these patterns following you. Your mind is focused on the center point, it makes you very one-pointed and gives you a spiritual glimpse. Mantra means not using your sight, but using your ears. Suppose you find an enlightened personality, and he might give you a mantra, normally the name of a god. The mantra comes from an enlightened person transmitting his energy through words. Once those words enter your system, they become part of you and they will not let you rest until it takes you to its destination, or spiritual experience. The third one is tantra. Tantra is misused and misunderstood because it comes with this idea that you have orgies, eat meat from the skull. It sounds like a weird way of making spiritual progress. The deeper vision of tantra is not drunken orgies. The Tantra philosophy simply says, when you notice the way you relate to the rest of reality, you polarize your mind and think of every object or event or person as either something that's attractive or creates aversion, I don't like or I like. Whether we like it or not, unconsciously, whenever we come across any individual or any situation, we'll polarize it as good or bad to make sense of the world. If you can stop your mind getting it whirlwind, attraction or aversion phenomena, and just become mindful, you can reach enlightenment. This is the idea of tantra. So try and stop the mind polarizing. If you can do that, you can achieve the highest experience. These are the words yantra, mantra, tantra.
I'd like to explore mantra a little more. We have mantras like Gayatri mantra, the Mahamrityunjay mantra, the Hanuman Chalisa, the Vishnu Sahasranam that people chant all the time. How is this different from a guru giving you a mantra? Why is it that people cannot just use these mantras and continue?
You see, prayers like Gayatri are very powerful ancient prayers Hindus have produced. They help you focus your mind. Gayatri is a very important prayer. It's the central prayer of all the Hindus for thousands of years. Gayatri is the only prayer in the world religions that talks about ultimate reality as female and says, I don't want anything from you, I just want you. This shows real love of spirituality, not the worldly life that we lead. Where do we get these mantras from? The mantra given by some ordinary person has got limited validity. All the great masters, they will continue to inspire and send you off on your journey, spiritual journey, by giving a mantra to you.
So in this series, we're trying to play a bit of a devil's advocate. We're trying to talk to non-believers and explain to them there's some kind of a pragmatic reasoning behind Hindu philosophy and thought. We're also trying to get at those Hindus who blindly follow rituals and customs. We're trying to tell them that what you're doing, do it mindfully. When you talk about mantras and them being so potent and powerful, I would not believe some evolved person come and whisper it into my ears and I get charged up. What's the rationality behind that?
Yes. You see, these individuals are not ordinary in the following sense. While they are talking to you, while they're alive, walking around, they are always plugged into the spiritual dimension they possess. They are aware of their spiritual dignity, divinity. Because they are plugged into the socket of spirituality, they are live wire. That's why when anybody went near Ramana Maharshi, the hair stands up. There's no electricity. It's just the fact they are coming in front of a spiritual personality is already fully enlightened, vigorously enlightened. So his presence itself will make you light up. There's no charge. This is a metaphysical reality. They do actually transmit this wonderful spiritual experience to others. Personalities can do that. If you ever catch hold of any of them, never let them go.